everybody. Thank you for coming. My name's Alex Green. I have loved cycling for years. I had always heard that Nippermar Park had some kind of cyclorama there, that it had had huge crowds coming. And I remember when I opened the store, people used to tell me numbers that I didn't believe. So they would tell me the Easter Day parade on Moody Street would draw 50 or 100,000 people. And I didn't believe that, and all these other things. And then I went to Al Arena's museum on Lexington Street, and I saw a photograph of the Easter Day parade, and there were 50,000 people. And there's Captain Kangaroo hanging from a helicopter, leaning onto the side of Cronin's Landing. And so I believe it when people said that, you know, something like 10,000 people would come to the cyclorama at Nippermar Park. These things are little things that get overlooked and lost and are massively important. And you just think of this sort of argument about environmental rights, just the basic sensibility of getting around, things that we take for granted we ought to take a look more at, and then realizing that you're at the center of the part of that, that you live in the place that drove that across a country. It takes a very special person to try to tell that story and to then do it so well. So I'm grateful to Sue Genser, who came in and told me about Larry's book, and grateful for this book, and grateful for Larry coming to sort of kick off Historic Waltham Days for us. I'm just grateful to have you here. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Alex. That was terrific. And just your setting the context, the sort of archaeological context, is real important for me. So I want to thank you and Back Pages for inviting me here, especially during the Tour de France, which we will all rush back home and take a look at later on tonight. Being back in Waltham actually reminds me of my own high school days, because I played in a small jazz group here in Waltham led by a man named Freddie DiPietro, and later on in a big band run by Vito Pampoloni up on Main Street out towards West, and some of you may have heard those names. So I've always felt at home in this city. And the book that I've written and my additional research on a Waltham cyclist named William Shakespeare is really helping to deepen that connection that I have to the city of Waltham. And I'll talk more about William Shakespeare a little bit later. What I'm going to do is read some brief passages from my book and then open it up for questions. The following is from an introduction to the Boston Cycling Craze, which was released last month by UMass Press. And just to give you a feel for Boston and its neighborhoods, in July 1895, Boston cyclists loaded their steeds of steel onto trains and steamships and headed off to the seaside resort of Asbury Park, New Jersey, to join thousands of other cyclists from around the country to socialize, politic, tour, and race at the largest yet annual meet of the League of American Wheelmen. The Bostonians left behind severe economic depression, burgeoning unemployment, the recent defeat of municipal suffrage for women. Women, is not well known, actually had the vote for school committee, and they tried to get the vote for citywide offices and failed during that time. There were anti-Catholic and anti-immigrant agitation going on, and a Protestant versus Catholic East Boston riot, which had only a few days before resulted in one death and several injuries, and eventually gave rise to an anti-Catholic Tea Party school. Closer to home, a bruising battle had erupted in the recently co-ed Massachusetts Bicycle Club as some members tried to push the women's cyclists out. In the late 1880s, and especially in the 1890s, because of an expansion of bicycling brought about by the safety bicycle, similar to what we ride today, cycling clubs formed and became full-service, all-season athletic and social organizations. They raced and toured, serenaded with special bicycle music, and paraded in uniform and distinctive club hats, along with floats, bands, mascots, and caricatures. This actually is a photograph of a the Styles Band from Lynn, which was a bicycling band, which was only one of many that paraded around Boston in the 1890s. They promoted ladies' events, had clubhouses for members and their guests, held parties, balls, cotillions, and minstrel shows, and competed with other clubs at bicycle polo and baseball. In the winter, they played whist and billiards, bowled and danced, and bicycle skated. The breadth of these social and athletic activities forms an important context for understanding the bicycle clubs of the 1890s, and the move to exclude certain of them, the colored clubs, from membership in the National League of American Wheelmen. And it provided a context for the struggle over women's rights, too. At the Waltham Bicycle Park on July 4th, 1895, an athletic carnival was co-sponsored by the Emmett Literary Association and the Waltham Bicycle Club. There was much racing, and there was also a bicycle costume contest for women having the most approved female bicycle costume. To decide the question of preference between bloomers, knickerbockers, and skirts, long or short. Bloomers, the closer knickerbockers, and the short skirts won. The long skirt lost. The winners in order were Kitty Knox, M. Costello, both of Boston, and L. Kimball. Miss Knox wore bloomers, sack coat, an ordinary bicycle cap, and gaiters. Miss Costello, a short skirt, leggings, short coat, and straw tourist hat. And Miss Kimball, knickerbockers, Eton jacket, no gaiters, tam o'shanter hat, and a sash. Some of the women in the grandstand showed their disapproval of the bloomer and knickerbocker costumes by roundly hissing their wearers. These were the long skirt traditionalists. You'll hear more about them later. The following week, Boston cyclists left for Asbury Park. Even on their cycling escape, the Bostonians could not avoid the era's social conflicts. Among the cyclists, Boston cyclists at the meet was a biracial 20-year-old, Kitty Knox, the costume winner at Waltham, who was associated with the Riverside Cycle Club, the major colored cycling organization in Boston. I use the word colored because that's what was used at the time. Also at the meet, the very same meet, was Mary Sargent Hopkins, daughter of a Lynn shoe worker and Civil War veteran who became a tricyclist in 1885 and then made the transition to two wheels in 1890. That's Mary Sargent Hopkins in a very dim photograph on her tricycle. Her husband is on our left with their daughter on a tandem tricycle, tricycling along probably in Medford, which is where they lived at the time. Also at the meet was Abbott Bassett. He was a Newtonville resident, the son of a Chelsea baker, and also a tricyclist turned bicyclist. And there is his wife, Dora. This one was called the sociable tricycle because they were able to ride side by side. It was one of the popular versions of the tricycle at the time.
How many people pedaled?
What's that?
Did they both pedal or just one?
They had both arrangements. Sometimes the woman in front would be just riding, and other times there were pedals set up so that the woman could use those too. And there was a huge issue about who was really supposed to ride in front and who was supposed to ride in back, which we can get into a little bit later. It's a surprising answer. Anyway, Abbott Bassett was the longtime secretary of the League of American Wheelmen and associate editor of the League's Bulletin. And there they are tricycling. This is on the Salem Common on the first annual Ladies North Shore Tricycling Tour, and both Abbott Bassett and Mary Sargent Hopkins are involved in that tour. Here's Abbott Bassett right here, and there's Mary Sargent Hopkins. The following week, the Bostonians, as I said, left for Asbury Park. And on arrival, each Boston cyclist showed a membership card, but Kitty Knox presented a problem. Some Asbury Park officials protested against permitting Miss Knox to remain a member of the league because of a recently enacted league color bar, and threatened to have a reckoning with the league secretary, Abbott Bassett. The Wheel Woman magazine, published here in Boston by Mary Sargent Hopkins, objected to the notoriety of Kitty Knox's confrontation with the color bar, and possibly also because she wore bloomers rather than a skirt. And, as you can see, she rode a man's bike. And even more, even worse from their point of view, she danced at the league ball. Yeah. But Kitty had her supporters. The Riverside Cycle Club and one of its racing judges, African-American State Representative Robert Timo of Boston's West End, had convinced the Massachusetts State Legislature to pass a resolution denouncing the league's color bar. At Asbury Park, several prominent Bostonians spoke for her, including George Perkins, leading wheelman and sometime roads commissioner for the state of Massachusetts. Other Boston cyclists also defended Kitty against the claims of the color bar. Their support reflected the city's cultural heritage as the home of abolitionist spirit still alive, although significantly weakened in the years since the Civil War. Let's do a little bicycling background. Starting with a few dozen participants in 1878 and picking up steam in the 1880s, cycling exploded as a sport in the 1890s as more and more Bostonians bicycled in and around the hub, or Beamtown as Boston was known even then. They rode from their homes and clubhouses to well-known meetup places like the Chestnut Hill Reservoir, or the brand new Boston Public Library, to inns such as Bailey's in South Natick, the Massapoit House in Sharon, Kimball's in Cohasset, the Boscobel in Lynn, the Woodland Park and the Norumbega Park Pavilion in Auburndale, the Whitney House in Westboro, the Pavilion in Gloucester, and the Wolf Tavern in Newburyport, all now long gone. But during the cycling craze, jolly places to socialize. Cyclists were forced to negotiate these social spaces along fault lines of race, ethnicity, religion, class, and gender. Some Bostonians were upper middle class professionals, such as the dentist Walter Kendall, who commuted from his Quincy home to offices in Boston and Randolph. And leading businessmen like Albert Pope of the Pope Manufacturing Company, promoter of the first wheel around the hub of 1879. Here's a picture taken during the wheel around the hub. A particular picture was taken in Hyde Park as they took a rest from the road. The story of this event was published in Scribner's Magazine and kick-started bicycling all across the nation. We Bostonians are responsible for that. A broader range of Bostonians joined the sport, including the sons and daughters of skilled workers, like Maggie Kirkwood of Malden, the daughter of an English immigrant gunsmith, and Lizzie Savage, daughter of a Boston oysterman, who set records for a total annual cycling mileage, up in the thousands. Fanny Pitt, a proofreader and the daughter of an Augusta, Maine house carpenter, led two women's clubs, the Woodbridge in North Cambridge and the Bostonian in the South End. The descendants of successful German Jewish immigrant families like Leo Abraham and Aaron Wolfson rose to leadership in Boston cycling organizations. There were African American Boston natives like Newton High School graduate Joseph Gardner Holmes, and migrants from the Tidewater region of Virginia like Riverside Cycle Club president Thomas Bowser, and from New Jersey like cycle shop owner James Harvey Conover. Yankees left poor rural communities in New Hampshire and Maine and rose through the cycling ranks. Still others were Irish and Canadian immigrants or their children, such as Daniel Dwyer, a native of Bearhaven, County Cork, and captain of the Eagle Cycle Club of the Young Men's Catholic Association. Henry R. Foon, Chelsea's Winnisimmet Cycle Club president was the only known Chinese-American in Boston cycling. In October 1894, Arfoon joined the Winnisimmet Club Century Race, circling eight times around a 12.5-mile course through Chelsea, Revere, Linden, Cliftondale, and Saugus. Fast young racers, including Nat Buffler, Eddie McDuffie, and Burns Pierce, all competed. The race started well, but the last 50 miles were done in a torrential rainstorm. The riders were soon covered with a thick coating of mud, and it was only with great difficulty that they could be distinguished as they crossed the mark. Worse still, due to the road conditions, seven men took to the sidewalk in Revere, but a policeman was waiting for them and deliberately toppled them from their bicycles and then took them to the station house in the pelting rain. Butler, McDuffie, and Arfoon, along with most of the field, failed to finish. Nationally famous local riders like Butler, McDuffie, and the great African-American champion Major Taylor all raced in Boston. They were fierce competitors, but also teammates on the Boston Pursuit Team, the very first integrated professional sports team in America. And there's Major Taylor and his teammates, Burns Pierce, the Butler brothers, and Eddie McDuffie. On July 21st, 1897, they defeated a Philadelphia team under the lights at the renowned Cambridge Cycle Park a few hundred feet from the Charles River. There's the cycle park right there.
Do you know where it is?
Yes, I do. It is no longer.
Yeah.
First of all, the illustration is not correct because the cycle park itself was on land that became the Necco candy factory and now Novartis. That area there was where the cycle park actually was. And it caused me a lot of grief to figure that out, to tell you the truth. This was like a fanciful illustration. It was not correct. But you can see, interestingly enough, here is either four or five people on a pacing tandem that would have been used to pace the racers around the track. There were a few cyclists among the recent and poorest arrivals from southern Italy and eastern Europe. But the North End's Boston Italian wheelmen and their president, the immigrant storekeeper Gesualdo Turco, made a brief appearance. The Schmuckler brothers from Lithuania became Berkowitzes on arriving in America and founded a cycle business called Hub Cycles in 1897 that lasted more than half a century. There are the Schmuckler Berkowitzes. In the process, some of the family changed again the family name to Beckwith. So today we have a whole Schmuckler Berkowitz Beckwith genealogy with its roots in the bicycle business. West Ender Annie Cohen Kachowski had three young children in rapid succession and then left them behind in June 1894 to set off around the world. Annie had virtually no cycling experience and never belonged to a local cycling club, but she wangled Pope Manufacturing Company into giving her a bicycle for the trip. The Londonderry Lithia Water Company gave her cash to change her name temporarily to Londonderry and carry a sign on the back of her bicycle advertising their bottled water. Annie, a slight 23-year-old, left in a long skirt on a 42-pound woman's bicycle. But these became onerous, as you can imagine. And by the time she arrived in Chicago, she'd abandoned the skirt for bloomers, and she also abandoned Pope's heavy bicycle for a lighter sterling diamond frame. We've got a hickory sterling man sitting in the audience right here. And she also changed over, as I said, to bloomers. She was riding a man's bicycle by the time she got to Chicago, which had a much lighter frame. The Lakes District of Waltham and Auburndale became a favorite destination for bicyclists, and it is easy to see why. Cyclists could go to the new Waltham Cycle Park to watch the races, or to Norumbega for a steamboat or canoe ride. Picnic at Forest Grove or Pine Grove along the riverbanks. Park their bikes at a bike shed boasting places for over 1,000 bicycles. Watch a minstrel show featuring the Alabama Troubadours. It's actually doubtful that any of them were from Alabama. That was kind of a showbiz name. And have a feast at the Norumbega Pavilion or the Woodland Park Hotel. At the end of a long day, they could say goodbye to non-cycling friends boarding the streetcar along Commonwealth Avenue back to Boston. Tired from a long day of cycling and play, they could load their bikes and take the railroad home from the Riverview Station in Waltham, now gone, or the Riverside Station in Auburndale, now gone too. It's not the same as the Riverside tea stop in Auburndale. The area became wildly popular for young people, many of them cyclists, who would rent canoes and go up into the many hidden coves in the district to canoodle, as they termed it. The authorities clamped down and passed an ordinance that canoeing couples must sit upright at all times. That and the building of jail cells and the installation of telescope and cameras to spy on the canoodlers provoked petitions of protest and boycott, and the young people moved upstream. In 1899, William Miles, a former cycle shop manager, wrote an article in the League of American Wheelmen's Bulletin extolling the virtues of cycling along the banks of the Charles River. He proposed a cycle path along the Charles from Boston through Waltham to Auburndale. And we're finally getting there, now more than 100 years later. As the cycling craze died in 1900, some cyclists capitalized on the public's quest for speed in new fields: pace track races, motorcycles, and automobiles. Cycling entrepreneurs like Maine transplant James Linscott and local Malden boy Alvin Fuller went on to make it in the auto business. Fuller went on to political fame, too, as governor of Massachusetts in the 1920s. The big story is this. Cyclists strove for greater space for bicycling and bicycles. They also strove for upward social mobility through cycling, and they achieved it, at least briefly. They were people who were interested in getting somewhere. Many were marginalized again when the bicycling world collapsed in the late 1890s, and the social climate worsened, especially for African Americans. One example is James Harvey Conover, a black racer, bicycle mechanic, and shop owner in South End. Conover got out of the declining bicycling business, became an expert in ice surfacing, and opened up a shop specializing in skate sharpening on St. Botolph Street, close to the Boston Arena, now the Matthews Arena. Others continued to struggle uphill against the color bar restrictions in employment. Waltham's William Shakespeare is another case in point. In a 1923 obituary, the Boston Herald noted, William Shakespeare died at his home, 229 South Street. Mr. Shakespeare, who had conducted a bicycle shop some years ago, was among the first citizens of Waltham that used the old high-wheel bicycle. William Shakespeare emigrated from Coventry, Warwickshire, in England in about 1867. He followed a long line of skilled metalworking migrants at a time of opportunity in the United States. He lived for a few years at the corner of Pine and Newton Streets in West Newton, near its border with Waltham, while he worked as an engraver, eventually for the Waltham Watch Company. He got in early in the bicycle business. Bicycling World reported in December 1980 that, quote, he has taken an agency for Columbia and Mustang bicycles in Waltham. He was an early member of the Waltham Bicycle Club, elected its president in January 1981. While his Boston Herald obituary speaks of him as a high-wheeler bicyclist, the contemporaneous reports suggests that he was an early tricyclist. Abbott Bassett reported him at the first tricycle meet and run in America at Boston, starting from Trinity, now Copley Square, in 1883. There's really his bicycle shop on Lexington Street, 15 Lexington Street, right next to the, or close by the museum. Correct, Al? Yeah, close by the museum. And here's a picture of William Shakespeare and his wife, Jane. Here they are on a tandem tricycle. And this is part of the third annual Ladies North Shore Tricycle Tour. And that picture is taken very likely up in Beverly, where the event started.
That looks like a Rudge Humber, which I think was made in Coventry.
It could very well have been. Most of the tricycles at that time were made in England and imported in those very early years. Both Abbott and William Shakespeare, it was noted on this run in 1883, rode Coventry Rotary tricycles. Now, this is kind of an important point, and by the way, I want to thank Al Arena for providing. He's got this picture in the museum, in the old museum, I guess is what you call it, Al, and allowed me just the other day to take this photograph. And what's important about this, actually, is look at that is a tricycle. It's got three wheels. And yet, if you notice, it's got the sort of nascent beginnings of a bicycle as we think about it today, because there's a chain drive here. And if you can think of it, all they got to do is transfer the chain drive to the back wheel and add pneumatic tires and a few other things, and you've got a bicycle essentially like we've got today. So in the 1890s, he was doing business in bicycles near the corner of Moody and Pine Streets, now the Watch City Brewery. As bicycling declined, his business was more broadly sporting goods, and keeping bees. Here's actually a picture of the Waltham Cycle Park. And at that park, he was... His son, who's also named William Shakespeare, placed third in the novice race. So the family bicycling tradition continued.
Where was this?
What's that?
Where was this?
It's now called Nippermeyer Park, and it's up kind of in back of the old Waltham City Hospital. If you go up the street, if you go up South Street to Shakespeare, and take a little ride at Shakespeare, you're right into the park where the track existed at that time, and it's now mostly a baseball field and a few other activities going on there. The family was ideally located for the races. Their home at the corner of South Street and Shakespeare Road was just a few hundred feet from the Waltham Cycle Park, now Nippermeyer Park. Shakespeare's literary skills were on display for a recitation at an evening meetup with the Massachusetts and Nonantum clubs at the Nonantum Clubhouse. And I can imagine they probably asked him to come and recite a little Shakespeare. In the 1890s, Shakespeare was doing business in bicycles near the corner of Moody Streets, as I said, now Watch City Brewery. As bicycling declined, his business was more broadly sporting goods, and the store was clerked by his son Charles. But by 1905, he was in business in hardware. As that, too, apparently declined, he returned to factory work as a machinist or engraver, and there is evidence of his interest in keeping bees in the business of honey. According to the 1910 census, he and both sons worked as machinists at the nearby Judson L. Thompson Company, a manufacturer of buckles. Just before his death, he was working back where he started as an engraver the Watch Factory. So William Shakespeare's arc followed that of bicycling, a rise, a new place to try out multiple talents, and then a decline, just as the bicycling business did. Kitty Knox's untimely death in 1900, the end of Mary Sargent Hopkins' cycling journalism and her move to Manhattan, and Abbott Bassett's shuttering of the League of American Wheelmen offices in Boston and retreat to publish the League's bulletin single-handedly from his home in Newtonville, all served to mark the end of Boston's cycling craze. Well, to avoid ending things on such a down note, I want to introduce you to another aspect of bicycling from my chapter, Abbott Bassett, The League of American Wheelmen and the Cycling Poets. Small fragments of cycling poetry appeared frequently in the local newspapers, such as this one from the Somerville Journal. Mary had a little lamb, but both had long been dead. If Mary were alive today, she'd want a wheel instead. The girl Scorcher, who Scorcher meant an overly speedy cyclist according to the conventions of the time. The girl Scorcher was warned in another poem, "Take her up tenderly, lift her with care, fashioned so slenderly, young and so fair. One more unfortunate, pardon our weep, trying to scorch, but she's all in a heap." One poet cyclist from the 1879 Wheel Around the Hub, featured in that picture of the big wheels at Hyde Park, was named Joseph Dalton. He was referred to as a gentleman of means and leisure. In his 1880 book, Lyra Bicycla, he rewrote famous poets to introduce cycling themes. He called several of these creations very much translated from Longfellow, including The Celestial Cycler, Song of the Silent Wheel, and The Cycle of the Road. Another series included Sonnets by William Shakespeare. And he advertised a special manuscript with racy editions for 10 cents more, available only at his Union Park South End home. At the time of the League's Silver Jubilee in 1905, with bicycling in decline, to arise again as a force in the Renaissance of the 1970s, Quincy Quilby, treasurer of the Boston Theater, now the Boston Opera House on Washington Street, and a leading cyclist, penned this verse, and I would like to close with it. 25 years of wheeling, pleasant and quickly passed. 25 years of pedal and puff, on the top of the hill at last. 25 years of health and strength, of frolic and fun galore. Our lungs breathe deep, our hearts beat strong, and we're ready for 25 more. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. In 1895 in front of the brand new Boston Public Library. So, I'm happy to answer questions, comments. Yes?
So why did bicycling go down in popularity?
That's a question that's frequently asked, and I'm glad you asked it. Why did it decline? It's a subject of some debate. It is a fairly easy for people to say it's because of the automobile, but that's not why. Because it started to decline even before the automobiles really came into being. The basic reason is that, as far as we can tell, it was a victim of its own success in the sense that it started out in the late 1870s and early 1880s as really an upper-middle-class pastime. The cycling manufacturers said, well, we got to increase our market. So they all scrambled to build more bicycles, and the price of bicycles collapsed because of the overabundance of them by that time, it kind of slid down the social class scale, if you will, and more people got involved in the business, which is fine. But then those upper middle class cyclists who started out with it said, well, you know, that's not for us anymore. So by the end of the 1890s, really by 1900, the whole business had collapsed. Abbott Bassett had a staff of probably, when I counted the picture of his office, I think a staff of eight when they were in Boston publishing the newsletters and the business of the League of American Women. And by 1905, he was basically publishing it on his own, like I said, out of his house in Newtonville.
First you have the tricycles, and when did they really switch over to the regular, what we think of as
bicycles? The regular bicycles, yeah, in 1887. That's when the first safety bicycles really began to come into being. Gradually over the next 3-4 years, the bicycles became more and more dominant, and part of that is that many more women began to cycle, because they had the safety bicycles. Before that, you were either condemned to a high wheeler, which was basically amenable for pretty young and strong men, and everybody else was on a tricycle. And you can imagine that a tricycle was a little bit difficult because, in the way we think of tricycles anyway, they're wider, and you had to have three tracks. Think about it, a middle track for the small wheel and then the two big wheels. So you had to find a place in the roadway where there were three good tracks that you could cycle down. And that's why William Shakespeare's version of the tricycle was an advance. There were two wheels lined up and then the big wheel over on the side. And that meant that you only had to find two tracks that were decent. So that was a real advance. So when they got to the bicycle, then you got one track. So it's much more amenable to an expansion of cycling to many more people. In about 1890, they would run races in which all three bicycle types appeared. They would have tricycles, they would have big wheel bicycles, or ordinaries as they call them, and they would have safety bicycles. So these things went on all day, because you had to accommodate all three different types of cycles. By 1895 or so, everything else was gone but the safety bicycle.
What did they make the wheels out of?
The wheels were originally hard rubber, and then they began to get pneumatic tires, air-filled tires, and that really caused a great expansion, because they were much less hard to push along the roadways, and a great improvement. So the modern safety bicycle was a combination. It was chain drive, two wheels lined up, brakes, functioning brakes.
Yeah,
and,
that's important.
And pneumatic tires, making the ride smooth. It's relatively smooth. So, that's really what happened. Those advances are really what created the bicycle, essentially what we have today. Yeah, other questions? Yes, way back.
As far as the country as a whole, did cycling, just regular people cycling, did it also have a big drop off?
Oh, yeah. The entire bicycling business collapsed in the early 1900s.
So when
did in every city in the country.
When did bicycles are picking up again? I mean, Columbia and all these people.
Bicycling really had some spurts here and there in the early part of the 20th century, but didn't really pick up again until 1965, 1970, when you get a whole bunch of new people involved in cycling, a real push for urban commuting, the issues around Earth Day. Earth Day was in 1970. And that promoted a huge increase in bicycling. And a whole bunch of other events, particularly in Boston here, including a wonderful event called the Pedal Against Pollution that was run out of the senator's office. And they ran a Pedal Against Pollution, a ride all the way from Pittsfield down into Boston that he joined in the last couple of hundred yards. made a good campaign for. Yeah.
But children used bicycles growing up in the 40s and 50s. All my neighbors
and
we all
had bikes. That's exactly right. It was known as a children's toy. And that was really it, save for a few hardy souls who continued the practice of racing and touring.
Yeah.
But there were not many of them. It was mainly known as a children's toy. And that was one of the issues that had to be broken through to really rejuvenate the sport of cycling in the 1970s.
Distinguishing it as a sport and versus the recreational use that we all had growing up.
That's an issue that's really interesting one, because there was a split between competitive racing cycling and the more casual or recreational cycling, which existed even back in the 1890s, and which was certainly important in the 1970s up to today.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a whole racing culture out there. But, there are several bicycling cultures out there that we're aware of at this point. I've got a sequel to this book coming out, which is going to be on the 70s and 80s period. That turns out to be a pretty interesting time, too. Other questions?
Where was the Orient Factory located?
The Orient Factory was on Rumford Ave. Well, that's listed. It's listed there as Crescent Park, which is right over in that same neighborhood. I think the actual address was Rumford. And William Shakespeare's ad for his sporting goods, cycles, and hardware store on 6 Pine Street, which is, if you go outside of here, you go upside of the brewery, watch the brewery, that's where it is. That's where it was. Yes?
What sparked you to look into this? You must have known something, read something, heard something, and then decided to dig more.
That's a huge question. Let me give you the short version of it. I have always been interested in how people get places, both in a physical and a social sense. And I guess that comes out partly out of my own experience. I was a cab driver in Boston for a while. I had a time on a ship out in New York, over to the Mediterranean. I rode the rails for a while out west, and so I always had an urge to figure out how people got places, but in both a physical and a social sense. So bicycling was a natural object for me. I was interested in history, and then I literally fell across the name Kitty Knox, who is kind of the central figure in this tale. And I discovered that she had really been lost to history. She was an important historical figure in the 1890s who was totally lost. And I thought, this is a story that's got to get told. And through her, I fell upon Mary Sargent Hopkins and Abbott Bassett and all the rest of the characters that populated her world. And it was a story that would not let me go. And I've spent a lot of the last 5 years, as my youngest daughter would say, stalking these historical figures. And not only stalking the historical figures, but also stalking their descendants. And I'm really pleased tonight that there are actually several descendants in the audience, several descendants of William Shakespeare, one of whom is Alton Webb. I wonder if you would raise your hand. And Barbara Burgess is here as well.
Oh, wow.
And I also want to acknowledge the help that Al Arena has given to me in looking at some of the archival materials. I spent a lot of time stalking these people, trying to figure out who they were, whether they had pictures and other historical memorabilia that would be helpful to me in writing this history. And they certainly have been. I thank you very much for that.
You might notice the shirt that gentleman is wearing.
Aha, yes, get up. And
from the
Waltham Museum. Now you notice that there are 10 cyclists on, that's a 10, there are 10 cyclists on that.
Wow.
It's in the Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan.
And the important thing about that, you say, why would they have 10 cyclists? Well, in the late 1890s, when they were trying to get more and more speed out of racing cyclists, that meant putting a pacing machine in front of them to kind of break the wind. And so you had tandems, then you had triplets, then you had quadruplets, four cyclists all speeding away as fast as they could to challenge and break the wind for these champion racers. Ultimately, those gave way to motorcycle pacing because you can imagine to pay 10 cyclists would have been a pretty penny for any race promoter. And so those kind of went out and the motorcycles came in. And actually, that caused the demise of the Waltham Cycle Park because two racing motorcyclists on a tandem were pacing a bicyclist behind them and then flipped over the guardrail at the Waltham Cycle Park. Both were killed, and the whole cycle park really collapsed after that. It's a really sad but interesting story about the history of pacing bicycles and motorcycles. So that's a long-winded answer to your question, but others, what else do we have? Yes?
I might buy a pair of bloomers.
Well, I don't know where you can buy a pair of bloomers, but let me show you one thing tonight. This is not a pair of bloomers. But after I started writing about Kitty Knox, I went online one day and I found someone was peddling bicycling shirts with what's supposed to be her image on them. Somebody out in the West Coast is putting these things out. So it's a little bit of a testimony to what the internet will do. So I don't have any advice on bloomers, but you can get one of these. Whoever this was found out about her through my work. And then I'm surprised one day when I go online and I find this thing being sold. She had no descendants. She died in 1900. She was 26 years old when she died and was never married as far as I know and had no descendants. Her older brother likewise was never married and had no descendants. And I finally stalked down her uncle's granddaughter to Acton. She lives out in Acton. And they had actually some family albums that had written under a couple of pictures the name Katie Knox. And she had no idea who it was. This was the white main part of Katie Knox's ancestry. They actually raised money last year to put up a marker at Mount Auburn Cemetery for Katie Knox, who had been buried in an unmarked grave at Mount Auburn Cemetery when she died in 1900. And so the family, the Toll family, raised the money for that. We put it up in the fall, and the Globe came out and gave a great coverage and like that. Other questions, comments? I mean, I can go on all night, but I know you're getting restless probably. So, yeah.
I'm just curious how technically advanced the bicycles were in those days. Are they comparable to today's bicycles? I see on the picture there that they're pretty lightweight, 20 to 23 pounds, which is pretty light.
Yeah.
So, did they reach comparable speeds to bicycles today?
I would say so. Yeah, they achieved pretty good speeds, and part of the reason that they were light is that some of them used hickory. And in the book, I talk about some of the road races that took place, in which there was a real impetus to get lighter and lighter bicycles. But that meant that they became more and more fragile. So some of the bike races, you know, leading races would really break down because of the fragility of the bicycles they were riding. Yes?
Were these basically fixed gear bikes?
There was some gearing on some of the bikes. There was some rudimentary gearing involved even then. So a lot of the features were developed in the 1890s and have been simply elaborated on, I think, since that time. The frames were typically metal, but the wheel rims were wooden, if they were the hickory type. And there was a company, Sterling Elliott's company over here in Watertown, specialized in the hickory bicycle thing. It's called the Sterling Hickory Bicycle. He also played a role in some of the stuff around Kitty Box. But that's all. It's all, yeah.
You would to talk about sort of the rise and the collapse of all of this. Something you're partly describing the economics and partly the cultural, social
status
of things both. And you would say more about the rise of it and the cultural aspects. But was it mostly the technology became available and then the price point dropped and it spread through what other?
Well, again, it's just it's a question of over, partly a question of overproduction.
More leisure time also.
There was a bit, I think, more leisure time, but that got to be an issue too, in a funny kind of a way, in that there was no Sunday, there was a big move against Sunday cycling, and especially against Sunday racing. And part of the argument around that was that if they opened Sunday racing up, people that they would, elite cyclists, would have considered kind of undesirable would flood into the racing venues and make it uncomfortable for everybody else. And the reason for that, it's sort of interesting too, because if you think about it, people who are laboring for a living were working 6 days a week. So the only day they had free was Sunday. So if there was Sunday racing, then they would go. And that was a problem. So to talk about the cultural aspect of it is, I think, it's pretty, a pretty good question. Another part of it, of course, is women's dress while cycling, and more than women's dress, but how they cycle. Mary Sargent Hopkins, who was the publisher of The Real Woman, published here in Boston, basically says what she was after was what she called the ride beautiful. Not too fast, just a serene ride out through the countryside. That's what women should be about. And wear a long skirt, which was rejected in some quarters, obviously, by Kim Knox, and much praised in other quarters.
You mentioned in your talk about that there was a lot going on about where women were supposed to sit on the bicycle. Was the right position the front or the rear?
Oh yeah. That had really very much to do with a tandem bicycle. You know, you see people going by the tandem bicycles now. And when you look at it now, you'll see typically the man will be in front and the woman will be in back. That's the usual arrangement. According to Mary Sargent Hopkins, it should be exactly the reverse of that. The man should be in back and the woman should be in front. And her reasoning for that was that some years before that, there had been a horrific accident, and the man who was riding in the rear seat, the whole cycle kind of flipped. The man riding in the rear seat was killed. She said, therefore, the most chivalrous position for the man is in the rear. However, not to change custom too much, she also advocated, and the manufacturers produced a tandem bicycle where the steering was from the rear. So what they created essentially was a situation which was most chivalrous and most convenient for both to see the countryside around them, because the man was somewhat elevated, had an elevated seat. And the man still controlled because he could steer the bicycle. Other questions? Yes,
Barbara. I brought some pictures that I found of myself.
Oh, wonderful.
You can look at them.
We'll put those out on the table here. Maybe, Alex, we can get a little space to put those out. People can take a look at
I guess
them.
It's when they went.
I am so glad that you brought those.
Well, some of them I couldn't find, but this was in 1893. And it's all the tour he took of Maine, a lot of Maine and stuff like
all
that.
Oh, right, good.
Was he your grandfather?
would be my great-grandfather.
Your great-grandfather.
Wow. Yeah. What was his name? Should be
William Shakespeare.
Oh, Shakespeare.
Now, the family is, in one of the family members, when they got married in 1930, placed their marriage date on the same date that William Shakespeare got married to Anne Hathaway, and claimed that the family was directly descended from William Shakespeare. This was William Jr., I think, or William, maybe William III that claimed that. So I don't know if you make that claim or not.
She's disavowing it.
So, other questions or comments? Yes,
my middle name is Shakespeare, and I got stuck with that. And when I was in the Marine Corps back in the 60s, I never said Alton. I always said Alton S. Webb because I knew I'd be doing push-ups forever if I said Shakespeare. So.
There you go.
You're a descendant also.
Happy to stay and sign. You want to buy books from Alex there? I'll sign them. Happy to see everybody here, and delighted to talk more into the night. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.